Good morning and happy Independence Day. Thank you so much for coming to our service. Did you know that our God that breathed stars into existence, the same God that helped with the creation of this great nation, is the same God that's in control today? So even though we're living in these tumultuous times, let us celebrate the fact that our God has done some amazing things in the past, and he's destined to do some amazing things in the future. So let's celebrate those things to come. Let's celebrate the birth of this great country as we gather today for service. Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Will you please join with me in the confession? Lord, we confess before you and one another that we have looked to the things you provide rather than you as the source of life. We have taken for granted the most important things and lusted after the trivial. Yet despite our unfaithfulness, you have faithfully provided all that we need from day to day. Forgive us and help us recognize and be truly thankful for the gifts that you provide us each day. Jesus took your sin and paid it for full on the cross. To those who receive this gift by faith, God promises to not only cleanse us from all unrighteousness, but to fill them with his Holy Spirit and write their name in the book of life. Amen.
Thank you. is from Psalm 33. Would you please pray with me? Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, the people he chose for his inheritance. From heaven the Lord looks down and sees all mankind. From his dwelling place he watches all who live on earth. He who forms the hearts of all, who considers everything they do. No king is saved by the size of his army, no warrior escapes by his great strength. But the eyes of the Lord are on those who fear him, on those whose hope is in his unfailing love, to deliver them from death and keep them alive in famine. We wait in hope for the Lord. He is our help and our shield. In him our hearts rejoice, for we trust in his holy name. May your unfailing love be with us, Lord, even as we put our hope in you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now we invite you to enjoy the children's message.
Good morning, boys and girls. I sure miss having you all up here. It's been a long go without being able to see your smiling faces, but we will be together soon. God is in control and he is blessing us. Thank you for watching today, and I just want to start with asking a question. Have you ever gone all day without eating anything? What happens when you get hungry? I know for me, I get hungry, I get kind of grumpy, and things happen, and all I can think about is food. Today we're going to talk about bread. You know, Jesus is bread, and he talks about that in the scriptures we're going to go over today. But you know, there are many different references in the Bible, and the story that we're talking about with Joshua, when the Israelites went across the sea and they went out into the desert and wandered around for 40 years, God provided them with his special bread, and then they just ate for 40 years, just bread from God, and it was God's perfect meal for them. And so we're talking about bread today and being the bread of life. And so it's really an interesting story when we get to Jesus many, many years later, who is when we get to the gospel part where Jesus comes and he turns the five loaves into enough bread to feed a big throng of people. That would have been also God's perfect bread, because God made that bread. He couldn't feed thousands of people with just a couple loaves of bread and five fishes. It's like, Jesus is telling everybody that that's what happened. Well, the story goes along, and as he feeds these people, he finally gets tired. The day goes on, and he recesses up to the mountain and goes up and starts praying. And the disciples that were following him get in their boat, and they take off. And the crowd is gathered around wondering, well, Jesus, is he going to come back? Because we want to hear more about this, and actually we're kind of hungry, and that was really good bread. So Jesus then kind of got away from them, and he never came back. And the crowd starts looking, and they realize that Jesus isn't there, so they take off, and they think, well, maybe he went to the other side of the lake. And so the crowd's going around the lake because they're looking for Jesus, because they want the bread that Jesus has offered them. And before you know it, Jesus, the next day, they're found, and they approach Jesus, and they start talking about what's going on. And Jesus says, wait a minute, you guys don't get it. You don't get it. The bread that I've given you to eat to fill your bodies is one thing, but the bread that I want you to really have will not only nourish your physical body, but your spiritual body. If you eat the bread that I'm going to give you, you can live forever with me in heaven. That's the message that Jesus is trying to teach us today, and he's telling us. And so there's going to be a quiz right now. I'm going to give everybody a quiz. And since you guys aren't here, I'm going to ask the praise team who's gathered around, I'm going to ask this question. And I want, when I want to ask a question, who can give eternal life? And I'll give you a hint. The name starts with a J. 1, 2, 3.
Jesus.
Okay, they got it. Okay. Who is the bread of life? One.
Jesus.
Again. Okay. And okay, so the last thing that Jesus said was, everybody that believes in me will have eternal life. Again, who is it that we need to believe in to have eternal life? 1, 2, 3. Jesus. It's so simple. God loves us, and he, all we have to do is believe in Jesus, and we can be with him forever. Let's pray. Lord, we just thank you for your word. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for your abundance. And thank you for being the true bread that we really need. We don't really need this kind of bread or that kind of bread or even that kind of bread that's my favorite with s'mores. But God loves us, and I love you. Thank you. And now we're going to read our special scriptures for the day. The first scripture comes from Joshua 5, verses 10 through 12. On the evening of the 14th day of the month, while camped at Gilgal on the plains of Jericho, the Israelites celebrated the Passover. The day after the Passover, that very day, they ate some of the produce of the land, unleavened bread and roasted grain. The manna stopped the day after, and they ate the food that was on the land. There was no longer any manna for the Israelites. But that year, they ate the produce from Canaan. The next verses are come from Exodus 16, verses 31 through 35. The people of Israel called the bread manna. It was white like coriander seed and tasted like wafers made with honey. Moses said, "This is what the Lord has commanded. Take an omer of manna and keep it for the generations to come, so they can see the bread I gave you to eat in the wilderness when I brought you out of Egypt." So Moses said to Aaron, "Take a jar and put an omer of manna in it, then place it before the Lord to be kept for generations to come." As the Lord commanded Moses, Aaron put the manna with the tablets of the covenant of the law, so that they might be preserved. The Israelites ate the manna 40 years until they came to a land that was settled. They ate manna until they reached the border of Canaan. Please rise for the gospel. Today's reading is John 6, verses 25 through 35. When they found him on the other side of the lake, they asked him, "Rabbi, when did you get here?" Jesus answered, "Very truly I tell you, you are looking for me not because you saw the signs I performed, but because you ate the loaves and had your fill. Do not work for food that spoils, but for food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For on him God the Father has placed his seal of approval." Then they asked him, "What must we do to do the works God requires?" Jesus answered, "The work of God is this, to believe in the one he has sent." So they ask him, "What sign then will you give that we may see it and believe you? What will you do? Our ancestors ate manna in the wilderness, as it is written. He gave them bread from heaven to eat." And then Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, it is not Moses who has given you the bread from heaven, but it is the Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is the bread that comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." "Sir," they said, "always give us this bread." Then Jesus declared, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." Thank you. You may be seated.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, grace to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. We're inside the borders. We've been kind of flirting around the periphery for the past few months, but we're finally inside. Israel has made its way into the land that has been promised to them for hundreds of years. They're finally on the ground. And they've had a few things to do once they get in. They've taken care of the circumcision issue. And I am thankful to Byron for handling that passage so well. And I'm also thankful that Byron was the one who had to handle that passage. This week, however, there are two more activities that need to be done before their conquering can begin. The Passover must be celebrated, and they must eat the fruit of the land. That's basically the entire substance of what we have in our verses today. Whenever I come to Scripture and I see something that seems very important, but it's in just a couple of verses, my question always is, why? What purpose does God have behind having the people do something like this? I have a theory about this one, about the Passover and eating the fruit of the land. My theory is this: they need to eat the Passover and eat the fruit of the land in order to shut the door. Now, what do I mean? Well, it's always good policy to let the past be the past. Now, some of you know that I am a rural mail carrier in Kalispell, and as I drive around, I usually see some pretty interesting statements that are plastered on people's vehicles. Now, some are inspirational, some are inflammatory, some are silly. I personally have a theory that the more bumper stickers you have on your vehicle, the less likely I am to agree with any of them. But there was one, it wasn't a sticker, it wasn't a decal, it wasn't a magnet. There's one that when I first saw it, I really appreciated it. I really thought, that is a great way of looking at things. And it was written on the vehicle with one of those car markers. And it said, "The past is a place of reference, not a place of residence." I'll say it again. The past is a place of reference, not a place of residence. Now, I love that sort of image, because when it comes to that word residence, you know, residence is where you're living. It's kind of living in the past. Many of us are trying to relive our glory days. I mean, why do you think classic rock stations are so popular? Or oldies stations? Or for me, it's listening to the music that I listened to when I was in college and in seminary. We've been trying to get back to some time, some window, where we thought things were pretty good. And it's even one of the reasons that people have been scrambling so hard to get back to normal life right now, even while the virus is still raging and is even worse than in the early winter. The opposite is also true. And what I mean by the opposite is that there are some of us who have such terrible pasts, such difficult things that have gone on in our lives, that we are trying to run away from them. And that every decision we make is tinted by not wanting to go back to that terrible past. But that's still living in the past. That's still allowing the past to shape what you do here and now. So whether the past was bad or good, we're still residing, still living in the past. But reference is different. It's being able to look at the past and say, well, that happened, and it brought me here. Cool. It's not exerting undue force on your life one way or another. It's there. What happened, happened, and this is where we are now. I think this idea of reference kind of connects to our idea of remembering, you know, or of something being a remembrance. You know, like when that old song comes on the radio and you remember exactly where you were when you had your first kiss with your boyfriend or girlfriend listening to that song. It brings us back, but we don't live there. And remembrance is what God is after for his people in these verses. Remember both the good and the bad. Remember the full story. Because when we live in the past, we have a tendency to absolutize it. We look back, you know, they say hindsight is 20/20. I have a few issues with that. Because when we look back, we can often look at our past in one of two ways. We can look back on just all the good times and the great friends that we had and the amazing things that we did and like, wow, things were really great. Or we can look back at the past and see all the terrible times, the difficult times, the struggles, the frustrations, and think, wow, that was really terrible. There was nothing good that came out of that. Neither one of these ways of thinking is the truth. We sit in those two ditches. I seem to like to talk about ditches a lot when I'm up here. And when we sit in one or another of those dishes, everything was all good or everything was all bad, there may be people in our lives who remember the same time as us, who have gone through the same experiences or similar experiences. And if you say it's all good, somebody brings out, well, what about this? Or it's all bad, and somebody brings out, well, what about this? That person is destroying the very fabric of who we are when we live in the past. It is attacking our very sense of self and what we believe the past to be. But God wants to make sure that the people don't fall into either ditch. He wants to make sure that the people have a full appreciation of where they have come from. So how does the Passover meal and eating the fruit of the land do that? Well, the first one is the Passover, so let's start there. This is the one that's meant to remind us of the good. This is the one that's meant to remind us of the good of the history of Israel. The first time they ever ate this meal, God was busy destroying their enemies without them having to lift a finger and delivering them from their bondage in Israel. God is doing all the work, and the people just get to receive it. In fact, it's not as much a matter of, okay, you're free, go. It's almost as if Egypt drove the Israelites out. Here, just take all this gold and stuff, just get out of here. Now, of course, Egypt does come after them, but God delivers the people again there too. And so the Passover meal is a reminder, a remembrance of what God has done. It's a physical thing. It's a command for the people so that when they eat of it, they may remember that they have been delivered. Now, the next day is the second element, the eating of the fruit of the land. Now, how can this be a remembrance when they've never done it before? How is it that eating, you know, a pear or whatever off a tree reminds you of something? Well, it's a remembrance for the people of Israel because of what doing it causes to occur. Because they eat the fruit of the land, the manna stops. Now, the manna was good. I mean, it's, you know, you're not going to see it on a fancy restaurant menu someplace. You know, tonight we have the fried manna. No, you're not going to see that. But it caused the people to survive their wandering in the wilderness. But I am suggesting to you today that this moment is actually about remembering the bad of the history of Israel. Now, why is that? You have to go back to when manna first showed up. Today's reading from Exodus describes what the manna was and what God wants Moses to do with some of it, put it in the ark as a remembrance for future generations. But what that reading doesn't have is the beginning of the chapter. But to understand the beginning of the chapter, we have to go back two more chapters. Two more chapters is Exodus chapter 14, and that is the crossing of the Red Sea on dry land. All well and good, we know the story. But when we get to the start of chapter 16, the Israelites are now already whining to Moses for the second time. It's not even two chapters after this glorious miracle of delivering the people from the Egyptians. And they're already whining for provision for the second time. And so God provides for them. When they get to the land that had been promised to them, of course, the manna stops. Now, God had provided for them, but the manna also served as an example. God knew he was going to provide for them. He knew that he was going to take care of them. And yet, they seemed not to know that. They seemed to believe that God was just going to drag them out into the desert and let them bake in the sun. They seemed to not trust the God who was leading them and just split a sea in two for them. And the manna was a physical totem, a physical representation of that part of their history. And so in the Passover and in the manna, you have both the good and the bad of the history of Israel. And God wants them to remember that whole story. And God is remembering the whole story here too. Now, these two elements you should notice appear very early on in the story of the Exodus. Passover, of course, happening within the borders of Egypt, manna coming just outside the borders. What God is doing here with these two moments is putting a big bow on the end of the story of the Exodus. He is taking this time of this nation of Israel and putting this in their past. It is going from a place of residence, this is what we're living in now, to a place of remembrance. And I think that's something that we need to think about as well. I am a firm believer that there are chapters in our lives, or there are seasons, if you will. There are times where things are never the same after thing X happens. And in these verses, God is closing the chapter. The Exodus, Sinai, the wandering, Moses, everything gets moved from this is happening to me now to this happened to me. There is a new chapter to begin, the chapter of taking over this promised land. And Christ Lutheran, just within the past year, has ended a huge chapter in its history. Or, maybe more accurately, I should say, is ending a huge chapter. As much as in these verses we have sort of a hard ending for Israel's chapter, our chapters are often much more nebulous. One chapter kind of flows into another. And maybe the way things are going for Christ Lutheran right now, Christ Lutheran is 40% ending the previous chapter and 60% starting a new one. I mean, who knows? Who knows what the percentages are? Who knows what that actually looks like? God knows exactly what that looks like. God knows when something is ending and something new is beginning. Where residence ends and remembrance begins. But we as people don't necessarily have that luxury. In fact, that's one of the reasons that I chose the gospel reading today. The people in that passage coming to Jesus were living in residence. They were living in the reality of what Jesus had done for them earlier in John chapter 6 at the feeding of the 5,000. And so they're running him down. They're going to get that bread. But I love when they get to Jesus. It feels like, if you read the whole part, that early part of John chapter 6, it feels like when the people realize what's happening, they are running around the side of the lake. They are booking it to try to get to where Jesus is. And then they get to Jesus, and it's like, oh, hey, Rabbi, when did you get here? It's almost like a cliched, arranged meet cute in a romantic comedy. Like, I want to be where the cute boy is, and so I'm going to be in that place. And then, oh, hey, we just bump into each other. I had a version of this I did when I was in fifth grade. There was a pretty girl in my class, and I wanted her to like me, and I had all these plans that for things that she was going to like me with. Like, one of them was wearing a tie to picture day. These don't work, and Jesus sees right through this one. Jesus sees that it's not the real bread that they're looking for. They're looking because they filled their bellies. They were looking for the food of the wandering instead of the food of the promise. If we bring it back to Joshua, they were looking for the manna and not eating the fruit of the land. Because manna, bread, staples, sustains your physical life. The bread of the promise, that's what sustains your true eternal life. And we need to end today by noting the undercurrent of all of this. In all of these points of the story, as we've been going along, God provided. God provided the deliverance. God provided the manna. God provided the land. And in John 6, he provides much more. And you may be thinking, well, of course he provided Jesus. That's true. But I'm thinking of something a lot closer to home. If you have your Bibles, it's in verses 28 and 29. Verse 28, the people ask what they have to do the works God requires. Jesus answers like this. He says, the work of God is this. Now, in our ears, he's directly answering the question. You want to know the works God requires? Here you go. But I want you to notice something. The word goes from plural in the people's mouths to singular in Jesus' mouth. Why? Because when we look at the phrase work of God, we have a tendency to look at it as the work that we do for God. But that's not what Jesus is after here. Jesus is after the work of God, the work that God does. So when we talk about God's provision of deliverance and sustenance and remembrance, he even provides our very faith. Your very faith. The work that God does is that you would believe in the one he has sent. The one who is the very bread of the promise. As the people ate from the fruit of the land, we eat from the bread of heaven himself, Jesus Christ. And this bread doesn't merely fill our bellies or sustain our life here, although it does do that. This bread of life forgives your sins, gives us new life and new hope, and delivers our life from what it was to what it will be. And we get to look back and say, well, that happened. Cool. He delivers us from residence to remembrance. And that's definitely something to remember this week. Amen. Having heard God's word for us, let us confess together our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Join with me in the prayers. Dear Lord, we lift up our world to you with a prayer for peace and unity. We're divided and torn by faiths, race, sex, and now even response to this pandemic. Lord, fill us with empathy for those who see things differently. Make us quick to listen and slow to speak. And when it is time to speak, prompt us, Lord, and give us your words. Help us to embrace one another as your creations and not anything else. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Dear Lord, we celebrate the birth of our country. As we celebrate the birth of our country, may we remember all those that have gone before us. Remember those founding fathers who first sought your wisdom as they drafted documents to form this great nation. We remember all of those who have fought and those who have died in battle, united in the pursuit of freedom in the face of oppression. We also remember those who have fought for change and equality, for we are truly blessed to live in a country that empowers individuals to speak without fear. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Dear Lord, thank you for not forsaking us. Please continue to press into us in our daily lives. Remind us often to follow the example set by Christ. Today, more than ever, remind us to ask ourselves, what would Jesus do before we take action or exercise freedoms? Help us to see that the freedoms you have bestowed upon us come with tremendous responsibility. And let us rest knowing that if we are good stewards of all that you have given us, that you have promised to give us more. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Finally, Lord, we lift up the recent prayer needs. We lift up the Crawford family and the passing of Howard. Lord, we lift up Tina Register. We lift up Kendra O'Brien, Ann Herzog, Maggie Lawrence, the family of Dennis B. And lastly, Lord, we lift up the families of those affected by the tragedy in Olney. Lord, it's sometimes hard for us to see that you're in control when things like this happen. But we do fully acknowledge that you can make something that appears to be pure evil and make good come from it. We pray for that good, Lord. It's in your mercy. Hear our prayers. Amen.
We now gather around this table that our Lord has prepared for us, his Holy Supper. We gather wherever we are, in our homes, in our cars, listening on the internet or on the radio, or gathered in our parking lot. We come together around this table. Let us pray. Blessed are you, Father of heaven and earth, in mercy for our fallen world. You have given your only Son to die for us, to forgive our sins, and to give us new eternal life. We pray, Lord, that you would be present in our lives and in our hearts, and that as we partake of your body and blood, that we may see you and your will and may know that you have saved us. It is in your name that we pray. Amen. Let us pray together in the words our Savior gave us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. He gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples. He said, "Take, eat. This is my body. It is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup. He gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the New Testament in my blood. It is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." As you have hopefully been able to gather your elements, I would invite you to look upon the piece of bread in your hand and hear these words, "The body of Christ given for you." And then look upon the cup in your hand that holds the most holy and precious blood of your Savior Jesus Christ and hear these words, "The body, the blood of Christ shed for you." As often as we eat and drink of this meal, we remember the Lord's death until he comes.
Couple of announcements. One, thank you, Christopher, for that message. And also a thank you to the entire teaching team for the blessing, the rich blessing that you have been to our entire CLC family. Next week, Byron will be preaching our subsequent lesson in Joshua. So look forward to that. We will continue to hold parking lot services for the foreseeable future. Know that the council has been talking about how to get back into the sanctuary and what time and all of that. Obviously, this is a moving situation as the cases are starting to show signs of increasing. But there is active discussion. I would encourage you, if you have an opinion and would like to express that opinion, use the email council@clcwhitefish.org. If you have some ideas and want to share those, we're definitely listening. But we know that we don't have perfect weather in Whitefish, Montana, 365 days a year, so we've eventually got to get inside or find some other means to gather. It is our Independence Day, and what a glorious nation we live in. We are truly a blessed people. Our congregation is richly blessed, and I would like to take this opportunity, if you have the chance and you see Steve Haruza or Jerry Slater or Cheryl Pilgrim, please take the time to thank them for the countless hours that they have put into making these services work. In the multitude of formats that we are providing it to, it's just been a real blessing, and they deserve a hug, albeit a virtual one, maybe an elbow bump, but definitely a thanks. So I'll conclude with the benediction by simply saying, and now may the Lord bless you, as the camera follows me over. I missed that part, but we'll continue. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May his light shine upon you. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Into the world.